Hey everyone, Dr. Nick Delgado here, and we're streaming to you on these special holidays because we have a very important topic to share with you. We're concerned about the number one killer in our country, coronary heart disease, and the reason I'm doing this show on Black Friday, just before Thanksgiving, right after Thanksgiving that is because I suffered a transient ischemic attack, a stroke, years ago because I didn't have the information I'm about to share with you. So please join us. I'm bringing on Dr. Kathleen Gehringer. Dr. Gehringer, are you with us?
Yes, I am. Hi there, Dr. Nick.
Hey, I think it's probably one of the most important subjects we could cover, particularly because coronary heart disease is the number one killer. If you combine stroke, hypertension, that increases the risk of heart disease and stroke, various other cardiovascular conditions and diseases, it far exceeds all other causes of death, far beyond even cancer. And the reason I wanted to share people with this show is because I've prepared this information nearly the last 40 years to kind of come together and help you to understand that there is a way to not only prevent, and yet we now have the information that we can reverse heart disease as we know it. The mother of my son is shown here, my son Nicholas. The mother of my son, Shelley, died on Thanksgiving morning from congestive heart failure aggravated by hyperthyroidism and also from basically years of eating a Western diet in the Midwest, Indiana area. And I just feel strongly that people are dying prematurely. And it could be that those people who follow through on this information, it could prevent the potential outcome of this serious disease, this killer, that takes more lives than all other causes combined. Dr. Gehringer, do you have friends or relatives or patients who have had coronary heart disease or who have succumbed to stroke or heart attack that have had to undergo treatment if they did survive? Because usually the first attack is the final attack. 50% of people, when they have a heart attack, there's no forewarning and they die at that instant, at least within the time of the actual incident of the stroke or heart attack.
Oh, yes, of course. I have a brother-in-law actually had his heart attack when he was only 36 years old. Thank goodness he was driven to the hospital immediately, and they end up with putting like 3 stents in his heart at the age of 36. That's pretty young.
Well, I was only 22 years old, shown where I was wearing this blue shirt, and I was trying to suck in my stomach for the picture, as I always did for pictures, but I had gotten to be over 25% body fat. I was clinically obese. Dr. Bob Girandola at USC had measured me by submersion method, but also Dr. Girandola had measured me 6 months after I had undergone a massive and amazing lifestyle change after studying with Nathan Pritikin, after reading his book, Live Longer Now, and then getting the opportunity to go work with him. I could actually hold in my stomach for this picture. This is when I was 22 years old in the blue picture, followed 6 months later at the age of 23. And I'm happy to say that obviously I'm alive today. And then the follow-up picture at the bottom shows me now in my mid-60s as I continue to adhere to this program for nearly 40 years. My father had had a stroke. He's sitting there with little Roman on his lap, and his second stroke was very damaging. And we underwent certain treatments and therapies where he was on certain medications, but I finally was able to convince his wife at the time, Marilee, to let me take him to Dr. John McDougall. And I did, and Dr. McDougall remembers me going to meet with him and hear his seminar and event in Northern California. And my father came back with my brother Brandon. My father did not understand the seminar because he was really incoherent. He had a stage of dementia, Alzheimer's, that was very severe. And Brendan, his son, my brother Brendan, was living up in Northern California with my father and helped my dad, and Marilee helped my dad after we went to the health food store and bought several whole food items, a blender, a juicer. We made sure he had a crock pot, and we set up so that he started eating healthy right away. And over the course of that time, we put him through four specific steps that we're about to share with you. But within 3 weeks, he was talking, he was lively, he was joking with the waitress at the Thai restaurant in Paradise, California, and we had my father back. It was just so amazing to me that here people all over the country and all over the world are struggling with these disease conditions, and yet that's one of the reasons why I'm so passionate to share, not just that Shelley had died 27 years ago after giving birth to Nicholas. I felt committed that everything I could do to help people understand the connection of hormones, how we live, our lifestyle, our diet, our exercise, our thoughts, all of these contribute to the number one killer, coronary heart disease. So let's take a look at the next slide here. Let me just pull that up. And I think I can change. There we go. The real steps, and we're going to keep these brief because we're going to cover them in depth during the course of this talk, Dr. Gehringer. What are the four steps to health? What's number one, two, three, and four, Dr. Gehringer?
Well, number one, of course, we talk about detoxifying the body. What do you mean by detoxifying the body? What we're talking about is make sure you sweat a little bit. Put a little bit more movement in your everyday routine so you stimulate your lymphatic system, which helps to detoxify your body. Fitness, go into a sauna, sweat it out, increase your fiber intake. So when you put food in and you put these really great fiber into your system, it helps to move your bowel. And that's another way to detoxify the body. And of course, herbs and things like that to really stimulate your liver to actually release its bile and able to exit out your body. And number two is nutrify. Let's put all that good whole foods back into your body. Like, nutrification is really, really important. The reason why illnesses and disease come about is because you're really not eating enough fiber and enough fruits and vegetables in your diet to really nutrify your body, to put the real nutrient-dense foods, the superfoods, back into your system. And of course, when you cook, put a lot of herbs into your recipes as well. And supplementation is huge, because no matter how much we try to eat a wholesome food, it's just not enough. Our soil is so depleted of these rich nutrients due to, you know, it's just the way it is. And of course, fortify the body and make sure you built this fort around your body to protect your body from diseases, protect your body from illnesses, protect your body from these heart diseases, because a lot of this stuff is reversible. And people think that once when they get a diagnosis, that's the end stage of everything. And that's like, no, your body has the ability to heal itself. Let's just re-nourish the body back. So by fortifying your body, make sure that we balance your hormones. We can talk about telomeres. We can talk about stem cells. Mitochondria produce this great immune system that really protects your body from all these pathogens, all these illnesses, all these diseases that can actually invade the body when it's not healthy. The mind is number four. The mind is so, so important, because if you're mindful of everything that you do on a daily basis, it really, really protects your body in a way that it actually allow your happy emotions to really send that really great energy flow or the vibration that you're able to emit. And again, make sure that you are mindful and meditate, do yoga, things like that, just to relax the mind, because we talk about stress and anxiety a lot, and that affects our cardiovascular system as well. So to summarize it, the four basic steps in maintaining a healthy lifestyle is: number one, detoxify the body. Number two, nutrify the body. Number three, fortify the body, and the power of the mind.
Fantastic. I think that when we think about dealing with coronary heart disease and cardiovascular disease, there's probably over 20 different chronic diseases that Dr. Michael Greger would agree in his book, How Not to Die. And when Shelley, as I mentioned, had passed on 27 years ago, and we visited her gravesite, I have to say that it was very emotional for me. And I think back to those times in my life and wondering, what could I have done back then to prevent her from dying of congestive heart failure? And we know that thyroid hormones play a role. We know that testosterone, we know that our cortisol balance, there's a number of factors that play a role. But we also know that each of us can make a decision about lifestyle and health and well-being. And I think that as you kind of go through life and you think about the warning signs of cardiovascular disease, they're quite evident. Now, you as a practitioner, myself, examining people, I think it's going to shock people. Some of these warning signs are so obvious. And you can literally look in the mirror and see some of these warning signs in the early stages, because I'm sharing with the audience now, Dr. Barnes, who wrote up in arterial sclerosis, now we refer to the name as atherosclerosis in the medical literature, in February protocols in 1960. He did 10,000 autopsies from around the world. He tied in those with the highest, what's called LDL, the bad cholesterol, and upon autopsy, he found they had the most severe plaques when they had been following an animal-based diet centered around eggs, cheese, meat, and dairy product, chicken or fish. All of the animal products led to an aggregate buildup of cholesterol, not just in the arteries, but actually in the eyes. And I wanted to show people this because you can see in the mirror your own situation. And yet, when Dr. Barnes evaluated people around the world who were on a plant-based whole foods diet from countries such as Okinawa and some of the indigenous cultures of Kenya and Africa and other places like the New Guinea natives, just places around the world where all their life, like in the South Pacific, they eat basically coconut and beans and peas and fruits and vegetables and no animal product. And if they did, it was an occasional animal product, just like our ancestors going back millions of years. So it's interesting that they correlated directly cholesterol level, including LDL cholesterol, with plaques in the arteries and the diet. And it's interesting, if you look in this picture here, you can see this white ring around the colored part of the eye. You see where I'm kind of ringing it, using the cursor there to show. And you can't see it in your own eye unless you take a mirror, and you take the mirror and you tilt it into the other, you can see the screen, but you're going to have to tilt the mirror to look into your eye and kind of hold your eyelid and look down and then tilt the mirror where you can see it into the mirror, and you'll be able to see in your own eye whether you have a cholesterol buildup in your eyes. And it's a warning sign that you have probably the very advanced stages of atherosclerosis. Even if you're in your 30s, 40s, or 50s, it even starts in some people in their 20s who have been on their whole lifetime a keto-type animal-based diet. It's very shocking and sad to say this, but the marketers have misled people, and these keto diets are causing people to eat more meat and dairy product, and sometimes they avoid dairy, but they're eating more oils and fats and meat than in any time in history. And you can see also this condition. What is this condition in around the eyelids that starts to build up, Dr. Gehringer?
It's called xanthalasmia. And your body is just so smart. Our body is just so intelligent. A lot of times when a patient comes back, they're like, well, my cholesterol level, it looks great. Everything's fine. And I look at their skin, and your skin is the largest organ in your body. So I look around the eye, and they have these little fatty deposit around the eyelid. And it's this little yellow little fatty deposit. And they're like, oh, I don't know where that's coming from. Well, guess what? It's the cholesterol that's depositing around your eyes.
And yeah, see the bumps right where her eye meets the nose. It could form underneath the eyelid. It could form along the top. It forms in different areas. I just showed one image, but go ahead, Dr. Gehringer.
Yes, it can form kind of like towards the inner part of the eye, or it can also form around the corner of the eyes, towards the outer part of the eye. So these little fatty deposits, it can be small little fatty deposits, or it can be a clump of it. So in medical term, they call it xanthalasmia.
Yes. Yeah.
Is the correct term.
Correct. So when we see this condition, the next step is at my office, we do a carotid artery scan. And the carotid artery scan is highly sensitive. We take a probe and we use some ultrasound gel, and we put the probe right up to the carotid artery, which is the big blood vessel that goes up along the neck. And when you trace along the neck, this big blood vessel is about the size of your little finger. It's a very big blood vessel, and it feeds all the blood flow to your brain. And because it's readily available, you just put a probe right there with the gel on it, and the contact gel then gives an image of the internal carotid artery, the internal and external carotid artery, and the main common carotid artery. The internal external feed the different parts of the brain. And so that blood flow to the brain, as we can see in this thermography here, where on the yellow and orange and blue there, you can see along the neck is where the blood flow would carry up to the brain. The carotid scan itself, you see what looks like a tunnel going through. The top walls would be where the ridges are. If there's cholesterol plaque buildup, it starts to form these big, thick wall bubbles or plaques. Just like the pimples that are under the eye, it starts to form in the arteries. And those soft plaques initially could break off and cause a stroke or a heart attack, like it caused a stroke in me, a TIA, a transient ischemic attack. We can also measure the exact flow of blood going through with each pulsation. And this is something that can't really be done with the heart, because the heart is moving very rapidly and the image would be blurred. So you're not going to get a clear image with angiography. You could, because angiography, they have to send a special dye, contrast dye, and then you get the image of the heart, which is what's called angiography, right? You can also do an echocardiogram, and that will show the heart pulsating, and you can get kind of different measurements, but the echocardiogram really isn't going to show actual plaques in the arteries. That's why the carotid artery scan, if it picks up 5 to up to 30% plaque buildup in the artery that's leading to the neck, like imagine 15 to 30% blocking this major blood vessel, then it could be as much as 80, 90, or 100% blockage in one of the arteries of the heart. When I say 100%, the body will form collateral circulation to stay alive if you still haven't, you know, developed a heart attack yet. And so keeping in mind that blood flow from the neck to the brain, or the blood flow from the heart throughout the whole body, when there's blockages, of course, you're at great risk. And that's where most people die of heart attacks or strokes. And the reason is there's no nerve endings inside the artery, so they don't feel any pain. But if they had pimples all over their face, like when they start developing xanthalasmas, it's not acne. It's cholesterol plaques. And it's kind of a fleshy brown color, almost yellowish. It forms these oozes right through the skin, right, Dr. Gehringer?
Yes. And that's when they start paying attention.
The other place that can be measured is, because the carotid artery, as I said, is very large, but one of the smaller blood vessels in the human body for the man is the artery feeding the penis. And that's why ED, or erectile dysfunction, is one of the leading warning signs that you're about to have a heart attack. So if you're having to use Viagra or Cialis or certain medications to achieve intimacy and maintain a sexual relationship, you need to see not just a world-class cardiologist like Dr. Fuzz that I work with, but a cardiologist that's plant-based, whole food nutrition, because you need to learn the truth. Dr. Kim Williams, who's at Rush Chicago Hospital, has 14 cardiologists, and they put all the patients, when they find blockages, when the men have ED or if they have carotid artery blockages, or if they do what's called a CT scan. Now, a CT scan, a coronary calcium score, will measure how much hard plaque is in the arteries to the heart. And I encourage all my patients and clients who have a cholesterol above 100 plus their age and over 160, or if they've been on an animal-based diet most of their life, to get a coronary calcium score. If they've been on a plant-based diet, my son recently eats mostly beans, he eats some animal product, but his arteries were completely clean. And it's interesting, he's a little overweight because he's eating more food than he needs, and occasionally he does eat animal-based products, but over time, if he keeps eating too much animal products, it'll start to clog his arteries as well. So this is the number one way to detect the key killer, and once you detect this, you can do something about it. Now, I know there's a lot of people out there that think that they're immune, or that somehow when they hear about the Eskimos that they're healthy people and they eat a lot of blubber and fat and fish and they don't have any heart disease. Dr. Gehringer, you've had patients who you've sent for heart examinations, coronary scan, carotid artery scans. What are you finding in these people? Is it shocking to them to find out they have plaques in their arteries?
A lot of times it's really sad because we refer them to their cardiologist and they come in, you know, being on statin medication and high cholesterol medication and blood pressure meds. And they don't realize that whatever they do dietary wise, it really helps to reverse this whole process naturally. But of course, the scare is that, oh, genetically, you're prone to it because your father has it, your mom has it. Oh my gosh, you know, and then they get scared, they get paralyzed. And we have to educate our audience and our followers that your genetic loads the gun, your lifestyle pulls the trigger. So let's figure out what we can do to decelerate that process or even reverse that process as much as possible. Why wait until you're totally broken to try to fix it? So we talk about fortifying the body. Let's do what we can to protect your body from going down this pathway. And yes, you know, with your with the Intuit Eskimos, they're on a very high fat diet and high protein diet. That's why they're just prone to all sorts of stuff.
Yeah, Dr. Garth Davis, in his book Proteinaholics, which I highly recommend, he published his findings. And when he reviewed the studies about the Eskimos, and I reviewed the studies about Eskimos back in the 1970s and 80s, early on, the Eskimos did not eat much sugar. And even on a high protein, high animal diet without sugar in their diet, they were having what's called interdermal bleeding. It was this overbleeding because of too much omegas. And then from all the fat they were eating, from the blubber and all the fish and the meat and animal product. And rarely they would get some fruit, and it was like a delicacy to them. They love fruit and they love, you know, vegetables, but they don't normally get it in the frozen climates. But these people do die prematurely. They don't live that long. And now in more Western society, they're getting sugar in their diet. Now they're getting dental caries. They're losing their teeth. But mostly the loss of teeth is because so much protein in their diet, they can't absorb enough calcium. Even if they eat 2,000 milligrams of calcium a day from the fish they eat, the bones of the fish, their teeth are becoming brittle and falling out because they have so much bone loss. So these people, contrary to popular belief, are not healthy. They live a short life, a very harsh life. And when you read the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition cited here, 1974, and I have all the references that aren't usually readily available on Google when you search. So people just kind of ignore it, or they think somehow the Eskimos are a healthy group when they're not. So I would not pattern your diet as some of these keto and paleo people point to the Inuit or the Eskimos as some champion type of a group. If they pointed to the Okinawans in north of Japan, where they do eat a plant-based diet, mostly sweet potatoes, oranges, and vegetables, and rice and things, these people have clean arteries. They live a long life, very, very healthy people. And they don't eat hardly any animal product, with the exception of a little bit of fish, and occasionally some of the newer generation eating more pork, and now they're getting fast food into their culture. But let's go further, because the fact is that when we look at the facts about around the world, another culture, Dr. Gehringer, called the Maasai tribe of Kenya, Africa, these people herd cattle 30 miles a day. And Dr. Mann examined them because they were eating the blood of these cattle, raw blood, which isn't good for you. Imagine the microbes they get exposed to, and they would eat the meat of the cows. I believe actually a lot of milk too, which was a sour milk, almost like a yogurt. And they discovered that these people that when they herd their cattle 30 miles a day could pass a treadmill test because their carotid arteries were so large. They could force the blood past the plaques. But when the plaques would break off, it would cause a stroke just like it would in you or I. And also in younger people in their 30s and 40s, they had worse plaques than we do in our culture. So their diet was not protective, contrary to popular belief, although they had low cholesterol. And it was perplexing to scientists. Why did they have low cholesterol, yet they had plaques in their arteries? And with all that exercise, what was going on? Well, they barely get enough food to eat. They're kind of lean people. They're very tall people. And these individuals have a total cholesterol intake of about 200 milligrams of cholesterol a day from the foods they eat, from the blood and the milk and some of the meat. I'm not sure, again, to the extent of how much animal meat they eat, because it may be like kind of those sacred cows where, you know, like in some cultures, they don't kill the animal, but they draw the milk, the blood, and take the milk and keep the animal alive. So I'd have to check on that information from the original study. But they discovered the sour milk, almost like a yogurt fermented, lowered the cholesterol artificially, even lower than the fact that the amount of cholesterol they were eating. So it escaped all detection. Dr. Mann published his findings, Dr. George Mann in his follow-up studies, but none of the keto or paleo people point or even bring up the follow-up studies that prove that this culture is not healthy either, that they have plaques in their arteries from eating so much animal product. So why are they leaving these studies out when they cite the studies initially, but they don't cite the follow-up studies? Because they have something to hide. Or if they do know, I think it's rather tragic that they're not sharing it with the general public. This is an important study or finding. And if you go to one of my favorite websites called plantpositive.com, excuse me, you can read about all of this information. And Dr. Brown and Dr. Goldstein won the Nobel Prize for their research about cholesterol, particularly LDL cholesterol. And some of these animal-based advocates and food companies are trying to tell people, see, you can eat eggs, you can eat meat, you can eat cheese. Cholesterol is not important. It won't hurt you, dietary cholesterol. But what they're saying is that the body needs cholesterol, and so you've got to consume it. That's not true. The body can produce as much cholesterol as it needs, over a gram of cholesterol from the liver and from every cell of the body, but it maintains a low cholesterol, like other mammals, of about 80 milligrams per deciliter of LDL cholesterol. Human babies have an LDL cholesterol, and I have a granddaughter and a grandson now. There's gorgeous, beautiful young babies, and their LDL cholesterol is only 30. Now, humans on a low-fat, no added cholesterol diet, plant-based, are healthy and maintain a LDL cholesterol of 50 to 80. So they don't have to eat cholesterol to produce all they need for their hormones, for their physiologic needs. The Nobel Prize was awarded for this incredible research by Brown and Goldstein. And they also were able to point out that those who eat animal-based products develop high LDL cholesterol. It builds up, particularly if it's more than 100 milligrams of cholesterol a day, and it clogs all the arteries throughout the body, into the eyes, into the hearing. That's where people lose most of their hearing. Hearing loss, or they get the ringing in the ears, and they have various other problems that come about from high cholesterol. Anil Steinberg, one of the foremost cholesterol experts, pointed out when plasma cholesterol drops, the cholesterol in the cell does not. So the body maintains the amount of cholesterol it needs. It does not need external cholesterol from the diet. He thinks that the LDL cholesterol of only 10 milligrams would be adequate, and he notes that an individual with genetically low LDL cholesterol around the world, there are certain people in populations where they maintain very low cholesterol levels, they're perfectly healthy with a low an LDL as low as 15. My LDL stays between 50 and 60. I've had it a little bit lower and a little bit higher, but for about for a half a year in 2015, I was eating more animal product because my son-in-law had moved in and he was being kind. And I thought, well, all these years I've been eating healthy, it won't harm me. But within 6 months, my LDL cholesterol, my total cholesterol shot up dangerously high. It took me a year before I was able to clear it out of my system. I know you follow close to more like a traditional Asian diet originating from China and Vietnam. And your diet keeps your overall cholesterol fairly low, right? You give us an idea of you and your family. Does your family eat differently than you, or do they eat similar to you? And what is the outcome for healthy arteries in the Asian cultures particularly?
Well, I classify myself as a more plant-based type of a diet. So if we think about a circle, a plate, and then you cut it in half, and then you divide the half into a quarter. So a quarter would be definitely a little bit more on the protein side. The other quarter is the carbs, which is, I'm talking about the good carbs, the complex carbs, like the squash and sweet potatoes and things like that, or even wild rice, brown rice. And then the other half of my plate is full of vegetables. So most of the time, my dietary habits are 80% pretty plant-based, and the other 20% is whatever protein between beans and other stuff. But with the Asian culture, I grew up with a stay-at-home mom that cooked in the kitchen, so she prepared everything from scratch. And when I first went over to a girlfriend's house and I opened up her pantry, I was in shock that everything was in a can. I didn't even know mushrooms. You can get mushrooms in a can. I was shocked to see that. I was like, what happened? Open up her fridge. Everything was in a box in the freezer, one of those microwavable meal thingies. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it was a culture shock. And this is when I was in college.
Was your friend also eating eggs and steak and chicken and fish?
Oh, of course. Of course they were eating eggs and steaks and stuff like that when they're eating out. But what they do is that they just kind of like pop that little cardboard box into the microwave and heat it up. And I guess that's what they call microwave dinners or whatever it was. And that's how they grew up. And then, of course, they're like, oh, my genetic history has hypertension, has cholesterol. Well, because if your parents eat that way, you mimic the way they eat, so you become unhealthy like them, So it's a whole mind shift. It's just like our number four step, step number four, be mindful of what you eat.
It's interesting that a lot of the, shall I say, paleo and keto advocates point to studies that Dr. Anicel Keys isolated on six countries from around the world, and he on purpose left out Mexico because they weren't good at collecting data and they didn't even collect a death certificate. So it wasn't even accurate, and he didn't want to include it and mar the study. And he didn't want to include at that time France, which also was not good about collecting data. And yet some people point to what's called the French paradox, saying that the French people eat, heavy creams and animal-based products, and yet they have a lower rate of cardiovascular disease. Well, that's not true. Autopsies show they do have cardiovascular disease, and it also has been shown that because they drink wine once a day, they get some more fresh fruits and vegetables than we do here in this country. I've been to Paris. I've been to France. I see how they walk distances. They walk to the local organic display of food, kind of like one of those food carts, and they buy their fresh vegetables and fruit each day, and they prepare them. So their diet, they eat a lot smaller meals, too, and they're rarely ever overweight. But Dr. Connor went ahead and did a more extensive study in 1972, and they published the results from 29 countries because some people had criticized that Anicel Keys had left off some of the countries, and they claimed that he was trying to hide data and confuse people about the nature of one's diet. And this much more extensive study is rarely ever referred to when you hear the keto or paleo people saying and criticizing Anicel Keys, but Dr. Connor's study you could not criticize. It was the biggest study of its type. No study has ever rivaled the size of the study. And again, worldwide, they confirmed every culture to a culture that consumed animal product, particularly if it had egg yolks, which is the dangerous part of the cholesterol, which is very, very harmful and high in cholesterol, 268 milligrams of cholesterol per egg yolk, and steak, or if they included chicken, which is just as high in cholesterol as red meat, or salmon, which 75 milligrams of cholesterol per 3 ounces of salmon, or cheese, which is loaded with cholesterol, or butter. All these things, if you go to the website, our website, particularly nickdelgado.com, and register for the coming live webinar, you're going to get the real facts and the proof. You're going to find out about other websites that are teaching the truth and really how to get past this confusion. I have to say that we're creating this online course for a reason, because there's cultures in the world like the Tarahumara Indians, and they play a game of kickball, and they kick this little wooden ball, and the first team to get the ball to the goalpost first wins. The interesting thing is, it's not like your normal soccer field. They run nonstop. They're ultra marathon runners, 180 miles nonstop. It takes 3 days to run. They light the course at night with torches. And even some of the kids and the ladies run in the races, and they have a blast. The women run about 50 miles and the kids as well. And this culture just loves to run, kind of like in Kenya, where they love to run everywhere. But don't forget, the Maasai tribe, they run and herd cattle, but it didn't protect them from cardiovascular disease. But the unique thing about the Tarahumaras in Copper Canyon, Mexico, they eat almost exclusively plant-based: beans, panola nuts, corn tortillas, avocados, fresh fruit. Rarely do they eat animal product. It's just too expensive for them to try and feed animals, and then, you know, use up their crops to feed the animals like we do. And so these people are essentially plant-based, and also they're long-distance runners. Guess what their average cholesterol level is, Dr. Gehringer?
I would assume below 160.
The average total cholesterol is about 125 to 130. Their LDL cholesterol is under 60. Their HDL cholesterol is kind of low, and people freak out. Well, why do they have low HDL good cholesterol? Because they don't need that much HDL to protect them, but they have about a 30 or so to 40 HDL cholesterol. And even though they're long-distance runners, which normally running and exercise where you breathe heavily, particularly altitude conditioning, will tend to increase the good cholesterol. But again, this is a great example. But guess what happens when a study done by Connor again, when he took the actual Tarahumara Indians, and you know how they always tell people, well, if you eat eggs or meat, it doesn't increase your cholesterol. But they always take people with already high cholesterol levels, people who are already eating eggs and meat, and they already have a very high cholesterol. And then if you add one more egg to their diet, their cholesterol hardly goes up 2 or 3 points. And that's where they said in the studies done by the food industry, which over 19 of all the medical studies done, reported in the medical journals in the last 20 years, have been done by big food industry, because we had already proven in the original research back in the 1960s, 70s, and early 80s that there was no reason to do any more studies. We already had the proof. So when you give eggs to people on a high cholesterol diet, their cholesterol won't go up much. And so that's where all these people say cholesterol is a myth. They say, don't worry about it. It has no effect when you eat cholesterol added to your diet. But here's what happens when you give eggs, even one or two eggs, to Tarahumara Indians each day. And the average person, I ask them, what do you eat for breakfast? They say, well, I get my protein from eggs. And I say, why? And they say, well, cholesterol's safe and I need my protein. Well, what's the protein based on? It's based on rat studies. Eggs are absorbed better for rats, not for humans. Humans absorb protein from rice, of all things, and sweet potatoes and vegetables better than we do from eggs or meat. This has been proven by Dr. Reddy, by Dr. Lee, by Dr. Knapp in studies on children and adults in another webinar we have. But the Tarahumara Indians, when you give them with their low cholesterol of 130 and you give them an egg a day, within a month, their cholesterol skyrockets up to nearly 200, which is the danger risk level where most people die of heart attacks and strokes in our country. Guess what happens after a month when you take them off the eggs? What happens to their cholesterol?
Of course it goes down.
It reverts back to their ideal low level because it hasn't saturated their tissues yet. So they did this month after month. They gave them eggs and the cholesterol went up for a month. They took them off. It went down. They gave it back. It went up. They took them off. It went back down. Guess what happens when you put an American with already high cholesterol saturated in their eyes and their ears and their brain and their heart and in their peripheral vascular that leads to gangrene or ED, erectile dysfunction? Guess what happens when you give Americans one or two eggs added to their already high cholesterol diet, what happens to their blood cholesterol?
Well, it doesn't have that spike like we see in somebody that's more, you know, vegetarian-based or plant-based, just because their body's used to it. And our body's really smart, so it starts displacing things, you know. It starts putting a toll on other organ system, or it starts to deposit these fatty deposits around your organ, which you can't even see. And yes, so we see elevated liver enzymes, we see elevated triglycerides, we see other areas, and what do? They get tunnel vision. They just only look at the cholesterol. Or sometimes we see a decrease in their thyroid function, making them more fatigued and lethargic, you know?
Guess what happens to these Americans or those on the Western diet when you take them off the cholesterol after they've been on it for a month? The cholesterol doesn't drop hardly at all because it's already saturated in their tissues. It's already too high. Because for 20, 30, or 40 years, like when I was in my 20s, it had reached a saturation point. And adding, it would kind of be like smoking 10 cigarettes a day, and you add one cigarette per day, and you say, well, cigarette smoking doesn't increase the risk of lung cancer when you just add one cigarette to someone who's already a smoker. But if you take someone who's a non-smoker and you add a cigarette, you're going to cause cancer in that person, most likely, right? So you take a look then at a person whose cholesterol doesn't come down when you take them off cholesterol in their diet, then the doctor says, oh, it must be genetic. We better put you on Lipitor or a statin drug. Mm-hmm. And that, of course, lowers their cholesterol because it has very intervention levels at the enzyme level, but it doesn't mean it's safe. And we're going to talk about what happens with statins in a minute. So there are genetic tendencies in some people to have higher cholesterol, and there are some people who have low cholesterol with genetic potential based on monkey studies and human studies. But if you have a genetic tendency to high cholesterol, that doesn't mean you should go out of your way to eat cholesterol. It won't make any difference. It's more dangerous. You should be even more careful. You're the canary. You're the one that's fragile. You're at greater risk. If you're lucky and you have the genetics, which is rare. There's certain cultures in the world that have some people that have this weird genetic difference where they can eat more cholesterol than most other humans. Then, you know, don't even take that risk because it still could cause, you know, a problem. But when Hansen had monkeys eat freely and they were already obese monkeys with a tendency towards diabetes, they tended to overeat and developed a high percentage of fat cells. Whereas the monkeys who were lean genetically had a lower percent of fat, had better hormonal balance, and became satisfied from eating typical bananas, sweet potatoes, vegetables, and healthy grains. But even healthy food, certain monkeys overate and gained weight. So there is a genetic tendency. But when visitors came to the monkeys at the zoos and fed the macaws snacks of bread and leftover candy, and peanuts and so forth, those monkeys got very, very fat. So much like obesity, which is different than cholesterol in the arteries, you're at risk. So don't take the risk of your genetics. And, you know, I think we all can blame genetics, but we have what's called epigenetics. We can change our genetics, right, Dr. Gehringer?
Absolutely. Epigenetic is how the environment, how you're subject to the environment, how you're able to change your genetic makeup. That's just fascinating work.
I did a study in 1992 through 93, and it was working with Tony Robbins, and we had people have their cholesterol level checked, and we did a microscope test. I'm going to cut away to the microscope test. We were able to measure these people, over 600 people, measure their beginning cholesterol, triglycerides, and blood sugar. And in the microscope test, you can actually see the red blood cells here. And in the background, this is my actual blood after eating typically fresh whole food. I've had some pineapple today. I've been eating, and I had some amazing cold press juice I've been drinking, and I mix in some beet vitality with the cold press juice. And I had some string beans this morning from leftover vegan Thanksgiving meal with whole grain bread. And we prepared some cranberries and sweet potatoes and a vegan turkey, believe it or not. We did all these things. Sometimes I don't do the fake vegan turkey. Sometimes I do. This year I actually did not. I had just all fresh whole foods, all the mashed potatoes without butter and a tasty gravy right from my cookbook, Simply Healthy Cookbook. And my blood looks immaculate today, the morning after Thanksgiving. Now, how many people can show the morning after Thanksgiving? Now, remember, 40 years ago, I had a stroke the morning after Thanksgiving, playing in the Turkey Bowl in Pasadena, California, against the police officers in a football game. And my blood was loaded with cholesterol and fat, so I was at risk. So I take this very seriously, and that's why I show you this study where I convinced Tony Robbins to put them all on the Simply Healthy Cookbook. I have a book here I don't have to show on the screen, but we used the, at that time, How to Look Great and Feel Sexy Cookbook, which is available online on Amazon. You can get used copies, I'm sure. And within 9 days, my published studies to get my PhD thesis showed that we were able to reduce triglycerides. The higher they were, the more they reduced, which is fat circulating in the blood, by over 42%. The cholesterol levels from 200 to 293, the higher they were, the more they reduced, but the average reduction was 30%. Do you realize this is as good or better than statin, the best Lipitor drugs on the market, just in 9 days of changing their diet? And people say, I don't have time to change my diet. I have heart disease. The doctor said I better take these drugs. I better lower my blood pressure on these medications. And yet we followed up with these people at 1 year interval. And some I had the chance to recheck 5, 10 years and 20 years later. And because we changed their values, these individuals are alive today, healthy and well, by changing their diet and following a whole food vegan type diet. I'm sorry to say that Tony Robbins himself is kind of oscillating back and forth with his diet. And, you know, he just went through a phase where he's eating a lot of big game fish and had the highest mercury level ever recorded. I'm trying to reach him through his mutual best friend, and we'll see if I can get words with him, because Chris Shade, one of my friends, is working with him to detoxify him from heavy metals. So, Dr. Gehringer, can biological medicine help us live longer? We're going to delve into this course. We're going to go into great depth about things you can do, not just diet and exercise, but we're going to teach the four steps. We're going to teach about how the hormones can improve your arteries and your circulation, how nitric oxide, certain plant foods, certain supplements will reverse these cardiovascular disease. And all the people have to do is tune in, Dr. Gehringer. And I know you're enthusiastic about this because we have some exciting opportunities for people in this course to teach them about how to reverse coronary heart disease, the number one killer in our nation. And I think, Dr. Gehringer, so many people are registering right now for reversing. You just go to nickdelgado.com and you'll see this screen, Reversing Heart Disease Naturally, and then just click in and put your name and your email, preferably also your phone number, because we want to text remind you about this incredible event. We're going to go into a three-part series, and we've only covered a few of the slides of this incredible event, and we're going to have a special offer at this event, which will blow your mind. I mean, I can't even tell you about the offer right now, but if you tune in, just log in right now to nickdelgado.com. That's nickdelgado.com, and the beauty of it is also by registering, when the webinar comes up Tuesday, December 3rd at 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Pacific and 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. East Coast Standard Time, you're going to be able to do live chat and ask questions during this incredible event. Not on YouTube, although it will stream on YouTube, but by going to the nickdelgado.com site and registering, you'll have a chat area where you can ask questions directly of myself, Dr. Gehringer, and some other guests that will be coming to this incredible event. So, Dr. Gehringer, it's exciting to share with people this incredible information, and they can learn how to essentially reverse biological aging as we know it. And you've seen it with your own eyes. You've experienced it yourself as well, right, Dr. Gehringer?
Oh, of course. I mean, come on, whenever, Dr. Nick, whenever you and I get together and we go to like the A4N, the American Academy of Anti-Aging, all our conferences, when we bump into our colleagues or our friends and even doctors that we've known for a long time ago, and they're like, oh my gosh, you guys look great, you know, because biologically, I know our body's aging, but things that we do, you and I do, hormone-wise, stem cell-wise, regenerative medicine, all these modalities that we're doing to our body is a lifestyle change, a long journey that we take where we decelerate our aging process. I mean, this kind of breakthrough medicine is available and people don't know about it. So that's why you and I are so passionate about educating our followers, the public, our audience, that these are choices that you're able to have at your fingertips. I mean, we're just so blessed that we have stem cell therapy, we have mitochondria organelles, we have pellet therapy where we can balance your hormones and reverse all these illnesses and diseases, or even keep things at bay by boosting your immune system, just like we had our Becoming Immune to Cancer webinar we had last week.
Well, I know you and I are pioneering the idea of combining the best of lifestyle medicine, which is a whole new field that combines the best of stress management, exercise, and whole food plant-based eating, along with energy medicine, which includes things like PEMF, how to bring that body's vitality back using certain structures and devices. I even have a Tesla device right sitting next to me. I would show it to you here in a second here if I could turn the camera here. Maybe I can kind of turn it to this level, but here you can actually see I have a blood pressure cuff here that I monitor people's blood pressure levels, but I have this amazing Tesla device that I'll show you at the coming event. Really, it's best to show that. And I wanted to mention that we're also using anti-aging, which is some people call, you know, bioidentical endocrinological intervention. We call it biological rejuvenative medicine, right? There's ways to combine those and the best of that therapy, and then combine the power of the mind. You've got the four most important breakthroughs in all of medicine combined together, all natural. Now, I say natural, of course, you say, well, wait a minute. As we age, it's natural to allow your testosterone to drop to very low, to allow your hormones. But when your hormone levels drop, your body thinks you're about to die, and you just pass on like every other generation before us. And I believe that if we kind of trick the body sometimes and bring those bioidentical levels up, and we modify it with the right herbs and supplements and exercise, we do all the programs together, you could do any one of the programs by themselves, any one of the interventions and protocols. And we see that because we have colleagues that are just kind of diehards about, you know, their particular treatment or therapy, right? But we watch them. I have for 40 years, and I see the result when they don't understand the necessity to include all four of the protocols together. And that's where I coined the name Delgado Protocol, but I didn't want to take credit for that. So what I decided was to put all this information available at this special event, nickdelgado.com, and upload these very special webinars that are never going to be broadcasted again except for a special offer. And believe it or not, if you become on our mail list, you're going to get, by going to nickdelgado.com and registering, the opportunity to get the link of the recent webinar that I spent over 2 weeks preparing my 40 years of research about becoming immune to cancer. An incredible talk that I know your clients, Dr. Gehringer, have been raving about and asking, when can I see it? Am I going to be able to see the replay? The only way to see the replay is you can purchase it online at our website, or better yet, you can get it for free by registering in a free offer as part of this webinar coming up, Reversing Heart Disease Naturally, the Number One Killer. What better than to learn how to combat both cancer and heart disease and get to the cause of these conditions? As Jeffrey Life talked about in a recent interview I did with him, how from age 54, 64 to 77, and now he's going to be 81 come Christmas, December 25th. And I got to tell you, it was one of the best interviews I've had, which really, if you go to iTunes or you go to our website, you're going to hear about his story and see his story and the fact that he had chest pain and he didn't know it, but he found out when he was going to a court event, a courtroom. It was very stressful and he had chest pain. So he went in, had heart stents put in, and he switched over to a plant-based whole foods diet, much like Arnold Schwarzenegger has done. And it's interesting that now Jeffrey Life, who's kind of the poster child for anti-aging, is doing at least essentially all four of the interventions. He's not waiting to let aging take over. I meet him up at the A4M. We're going to be meeting him up again at the American Academy of Anti-Aging Medicine, worldhealth.net. But if they just take a look at my schedule at nickdelgado.com and link back to our website, they'll get all the information and more. Dr. Gehringer, it's an exciting time to be alive today, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. And I always say that with the Western society, in the Western world, we don't think about how do we want to exit this world. You know, I always tell everybody that I want to exit this world the healthiest way possible. I would try to maintain every single organ I have intact. Whereas in our Western society, when things go wrong, they start yanking organs out. They start removing limbs. They start doing this and that. It's like, why would you do that? Let's try to really preserve our body as much as possible and more naturally.
Well, keep in mind, if you think you can trust current traditional medicine and you look at this book about statin drugs, the side effects, the misguided war on cholesterol. Now, we know we must reduce cholesterol, so don't throw out the baby with the bathwash. But former NASA astronaut Dwayne Duke Graveline reported that when he was given statin drugs, and he's not alone, his complete memory disappeared. He couldn't even recognize his own wife. He went off the statin drugs, and his memory came back. He went back on them, and he lost his memory completely. He reported that to the medical journals, and he said, look, I'm an N of one, sure, but it surely must be happening to other people, and it absolutely is. And not only that, if you're taking these statin drugs, which, by the way, to my last statistic that I looked up, statin drugs worldwide are the number one selling drug in the world. And yet, the side effects, not only the risk of memory loss and affecting your brain, muscle pain, liver damage, diabetes, weight gain. Why would you go on a drug when you can simply follow these four steps and not be drawn into the lull that, okay, if the statin drugs don't work, let's just go ahead and do bypass surgery. And if that doesn't work, let's put stents in. Let's even do heart transplant. It's all good for big pharma and big food industry, but you, the individual, you need to know the truth. And if you really want to know the truth, no one's ever told the full story until this coming event. Please register. I pray with you. Please register. It probably would have saved Shelley, the mother of my son. It probably is going to save tens of thousands of lives. And that's what I'm committed to do. I'm sincerely committed to saving your life. And even if you don't want to hear this on the holidays, you don't want to hear, wait a minute, the turkey I'm eating, the ham I'm eating, the bacon drippings, all this, the butter, the gravy, everything's being made wrong. Oh, wait a minute. Are you a foodie and you live to eat? Or you appreciate the idea of eating to live and yet finding wonderful recipes that's taken me 40 years to come up with incredible recipes with interviews with Chef AJ, Chef Roman, incredible, amazing, tasty recipes on all the world cuisines. You don't have to give up taste, although your taste buds will change. It's going to change, right, Dr. Gehringer? It's going to change. People are going to get the truth. And if they just register for this course, they're going to learn how all these blood pressure medications, they do lower blood pressure. I don't deny it. But look at the side effects. The increased risk of cardiovascular disease. In fact, it doesn't solve the problem, does it, Dr. Gehringer?
No, it doesn't. And unfortunately, a lot of these medication, when a patient is placed on it, and we're not here to tell you to totally get off of it. Of course, we'll work with you and have you have that conversation with your provider. But these medication depletes your nutrients. It depletes the nutrients that your body need. And placing a patient on medication is kind of like a band-aid for your boo-boo. But what I mean is that they're not going to the root cause. If your cardiologist say, hey, I'm going to place you on this, let's monitor it, and let's modify your dietary habits and really talk a little bit about, you know, plant-based instead of eating foods that are rich in animal-based, which really not resolving the problem. And that's where standard of care comes into play. And that's where functional medicine, integrative medicine, holistic medicine really, really needs to get that message out there and really educate our followers and our audience that there are ways that we can do by reversing these cardiovascular diseases more naturally. Because our body's really smart. We're able to heal. Our body has the ability to heal itself. Let's figure out the root cause of the problem and let's resolve it one by one and add in before you take out. What I mean is add in more plant-based, add in more fiber, add in your everyday routine, add in more steps. So that actually really helps you to get onto that right track like Dr. Nick and I are talking about, lifestyle medicine.
Hey everyone, please register for this coming event, Reversing Heart Disease Naturally, the number one killer. Register at nickdelgado.com. By registering, you'll get our original course that we produced a few weeks ago that took years to pull together all the information, Becoming Immune to Cancer, Far Beyond the Truth About Cancer, which, by the way, I'm being invited to speak at this coming year. I spoke at the Cancer Control Society. Every year I've been studying and researching ways to get to the cause of degenerative diseases, but I also have to kind of sort through all the misguided, misleading information because big food, big pharma have a lot to gain, and they're concerned that I'm going to tell you the truth and share with you what I shared with Tony Robbins, and you're going to get a copy of the book. This is the original book, How to Look Great and Feel Sexy, that you can get on Amazon, a used copy. If you call our office, we have copies left as well. And I'll definitely send you a signed copy of the book, How to Look Great and Feel Sexy. And in it, it has over 300 incredible recipes. It has all the findings and the core research. And my newer book, Acne Be Gone for Good. And the newest cookbook, Simply Healthy Cookbook, will send you an ebook offer as part of this coming webinar. And I have to say that blood doesn't lie. And I've been testing blood lipids, cholesterol, triglyceride, glucose, probably tested more than any single practitioner, find anyone for 40 years who's measured people at big events, including Tony Robbins events, where 1,000 people would show up, and we tested every person that attended and retested them 9 days later. Blood doesn't lie. That is the biggest message I've learned, and I know, Dr. Gehringer, you've seen live blood microscopy. I include that as part of the blood morphology evaluation along with the lipid profile and the carotid scan that we do when people come to our office. It's one small package, less than $100 or so is what we charge. I mean, really, truly, I mean, to get my 40 years of experience with this coming webinar, your 20 years of experience, I think people need to know the truth. So please register at nickdelgado.com, and you're going to learn about lipotoxemia, how blood, there's such a thing as fat poisoning from coconut oil, olive oil, safflower oil. You've all been misled. You've all been lied to, and I want you to know the truth, that when you look at blood clumped together like this, it should look evenly separated like this. In real time, any time of the day or night, I don't have to fast for my blood test. Here's an actual picture of my blood right now on the screen. I challenge any of those keto people on high-fat diets eating coconut or olive oil or meat or cheese to do their blood, not fasting, not after 12 hours of fasting when the blood clears up. I'm talking about measuring the blood right now in the middle of the day like I did Dave Asprey, the big promoter of Bulletproof and drinking coconut, eating meat, eating all these fatty cholesterol foods and claiming that he has normal levels. I have on Facebook, I'll show you, if you don't believe me, I'll include the link. I believe it's right now on a YouTube link. You should see the interview, how he kind of denies it and says that I'm some kind of like genetic freak. I have no genetics. I had a stroke, that is. I had high blood pressure and high cholesterol. I had to solve it with these four incredible steps. Dr. Gehringer, you know we're speaking the truth, and this literally could save the life. And once they learn the amount of fat, protein, cholesterol, and various foods and how to intervene, This is just kind of a glimpse of all the coming slides and the information. It's going to be the best event. You're going to learn about cultures around the world and about studies where people lost over 146 pounds following this protocol. How Bob Whelan walked across America on his hands, and Amber DeLuca, an incredible physique building muscle density, and all these elite athletes starting to follow this kind of program. You're going to learn all the latest steps about how to reverse aging even as you age. And you're going to learn about stem cells and the breakthrough at how organelles and how we can control the improvement in mitochondria and how to avoid toxins. What is the number one killer of menopausal women? What does it rise to, Dr. Gehringer?
Well, it becomes like one in three, you know, after when a woman reaches menopause, because their hormonal level starts to decrease, and menopause never ends. So it's, if people think that the symptoms go away, the hot flashes, the night sweat goes away, but the truth is that your body's still aging. So what can you do to protect yourself? And as a woman, we don't have those signs of symptoms of numbness down the left arm or chest pain like men do. Our heart attack is the real silent killer. So we really have to focus on the hormonal system and how we can use our hormones to balance and really protect our cardiovascular system.
And Dr. Gehringer, do men have to suffer with andropause and man boobs and obesity and prostate problems and memory loss? Do women have to suffer with menopause? Is testosterone one way an advent? And can we actually optimize people's hormonal levels even without changing their diet and proving their lipid ratios? Isn't it amazing, the studies that we're finding and the results?
Yes, it's absolutely amazing. Like testosterone, it's cardiovascular protective. And yet the medical literature out there kept saying, oh my gosh, testosterone, stay away from that. Well, are they talking about bioidentical testosterone, natural testosterone? Or are they talking about synthetic, which is the fake stuff that causes all the bad research and all the bad media out there that's blaming testosterone or hormonal replacement therapy as being not great for the body or causes cancer or heart attacks or prostate cancer. I mean, it's just a lot of stuff out there.
We're going to get into incredible details, but the webinar bonus and holiday gift and giveaway, you've got to stay tuned. But the only way you're going to get this offer is to go to nickdelgado.com. That's nickdelgado.com. And right now, by getting our newsletter, if you want to call our office at 949-720-1554 or drop us an email to the email at the office, which is health@delgadoprotocol.com. Or you just want to go to our website, and we have incredible holiday bonus specials. We've never had the products at discounted at so much at any time, including the free webinar that took place a few weeks ago, Becoming Immune to Cancer. Take advantage of these bonuses. They'll never be at this rate ever again. We have some inventory to move to you, and you're going to be amazed at products that help to lower cholesterol safely, like unlike the statins, which I believe are not a good choice. Although some of the doctors are still prescribing them, they secretly are switching over to these whole lifestyle methods. Like the doctors in Asia, did you see how well they received it, Dr. Gehringer, the four steps?
Oh, yes. I love it.
All right, everyone. This is Dr. Nick Delgado and Dr. Kathleen Gehringer. Be well, be strong. Please go ahead and register right now to nickdelgado.com. I'm glad for those of you who tuned in or picked up into our stream. We didn't stream on Facebook at this time because we went straight through YouTube, but we can't really answer the comments on YouTube until after the webinar. But if you go to nickdelgado.com, there'll be a place, a live chat, where you can participate with us. So just go to nickdelgado.com and register right now. Be well, be strong. Thanks, everyone. We'll be seeing you very soon. And watch for our live streams each day, teaching you some new updated tips. Absolutely free. You get it all right now.